Konnichiwa. Today, we're going to talk about something that a number of people have asked me recently, and that is, do you need to write kanji? Do you need to learn to write kanji? And by write, they mean write by hand with a pen or a pencil or a brush or a clay tablet and stylus. And the answer to that is complex, and there are a few questions involved in the decision as to whether this is something you need to do. But the simple overall answer is it necessary to learn to write kanji in order to become literate in Japanese is no, it isn't. A lot of older texts and indeed modern teachers and texts who base themselves on an older point of view say it is, but this really comes from a pre-digital era when if you couldn't write kanji by hand, then you couldn't write kanji, and then you were, in fact, not fully literate in Japanese. Nowadays, of course, most people write most of what they write most of the time with electronic devices of one kind or another. I think I write English by hand maybe twice, perhaps three times in the course of an entire year. You may write more than I do by hand. So the first thing you would need to ask yourself, if you're asking, is this a necessity in Japanese, is A, how much do you actually write by hand in English? Because if it isn't very much in English, it's not likely to be very much in Japanese, is it? And secondly, even if you do write quite a bit in English, is that going to transfer to your Japanese life, whatever kind of a life that is? Now, some people will argue that in order to know the exact form and structure of a kanji, you do need to know how to write it. And as a matter of fact, I think they're, generally speaking, right. The point here is that adults, when they're reading and when they're writing electronically, are not concerned with the exact structure of the characters they write. This is true of alphabetic characters. It's even true of things like the order of letters. I demonstrated in a previous video that you can read this writing that I have on the screen here. If you are competent and familiar with English, you can read this. You know what it says. And the letters are all scrambled up. And you don't do it by trying to rearrange the letters one by one. The A goes here and the X goes there. That's not what you're doing. You're grasping the words as a whole. And this is what adults do when they read. Children have to learn the exact structure of letters. They have to carefully look at them and say, oh, there's a B and that one's A and that one's T, so it spells bat. But when you're used to the letters, you no longer look at the exact structure or the exact shape. So we can write the word bat in two ways, like this and like this. And if you look at it and notice, the characters, the three characters in the word bat, all three of them are different in those two ways of writing. We're so used to seeing capital letters and small letters and treating them as essentially the same thing that we barely notice this. But if I said to you, was there something written over there? And you'd say, bat. And then I said, was it written in uppercase or lowercase? Much of the time you wouldn't even know, you wouldn't remember, because your brain interprets them as essentially the same thing, unless it happens to jump out at you that somebody's writing in all capitals in a place where they wouldn't normally do so. If you just see it on a sign or something, you're not going to know whether it was written in upper or lower case very shortly after seeing it, because it's not significant. And it's similar with kanji. People only really concern themselves with the exact structure when they have to write it, or when they're very young and they have to look at it very carefully in order to remember what it means. So don't we have to do that as foreigners? Up to a point we do, but the main thing we have to do is recognize the kanji, and then we have to be able to disambiguate it from any similar kanji that we might confuse it with, and I've talked about strategies for doing that in another video. But we don't particularly need to know every stroke in the kanji. We can spend our time learning that and learning how to write it, but it is going to take us a great deal more time than simply learning kanji to a recognition level. And there's plenty of evidence that adult Japanese people only know kanji to that recognition level. For example, there have been several studies, and there are videos here on YouTube, where interviewers just take random Japanese people and ask them to write particular kanji. Now, the kanji they choose are not the most common kanji, like inu or hito or mizu, but they're not obscure kanji. These are kanji that people see every day, read quite happily, and write quite happily on their computers or their smartphones. But what we find out is that in many cases, a lot of the time, they can't actually write them from memory. So they are not looking at the exact structure. They're not considering the exact structure any more than we do in English. They're grasping things in clumps in order to interpret them. So if we learn kanji without learning the exact structure, without knowing how to write them, then what we're doing essentially is skipping a stage and getting on earlier to dealing with the kanji in the way that an adult mind deals with kanji. Now, there are other considerations in writing kanji. One thing that people sometimes say is, well, I find it rather embarrassing not to be able to write. I mean, suppose I had a name in Japanese or an address in Japanese and I couldn't write it. Wouldn't that be very embarrassing? Well, of course, you're not making some iron rule that you will never, ever, ever write a kanji. If you have kanji that you need to write regularly, obviously you're going to learn to write those ones. And yes, if you're asked to write something in kanji and you can't do it, it could be a bit embarrassing. It's happened to me. Generally, I've actually just been able to write it in private and do a little bit of cheating with my tablet. And being an Android, I don't really suffer very much from embarrassment in any case. But the point you have to ask yourself here is that for these few occasions that might or might not arise, is it really worth investing hundreds of hours of study? And again, this is your choice. You may want the skill of being able to write by hand, and you may be prepared to sink large amounts of time and energy into acquiring it. And if that's what you want, that's what you should do. All I'm trying to say here is that you don't need to feel that you ought to or you have to. Now, some people are also tactile learners. Some people learn the kanji much more easily from writing them by hand. And again, this is a decision you have to make. Is the hundreds of extra hours that you will have to put in to learn to write kanji as opposed to simply learning to recognize them sufficiently advantageous for you to undertake it? And again, this is your own learning style, your own question for you to ask yourself. And again, many people say, I just want to have the skill. I want to have the skill of being able to write the language by hand, that I can speak and understand and write digitally. And that also is perfectly valid if that's what you want to do. But there is one point that nobody ever seems to make, and it's a very straightforward one. It is that what you don't use, you lose. Learning to write kanji is not enough. Those studies and interviews that I referred to earlier are ample proof of this. Those Japanese people who couldn't write numerous kanji were Japanese natives who have spent at least 9 years of their lives using kanji, not just learning kanji, using them every day in essays, in reports, in compulsory summer vacation diaries. In all the things they do in school, they are using kanji every day for at least 9 years. And even they start forgetting them once they leave school if they don't actually use them regularly because they're writing digitally nearly all the time. That is going to happen to you to a much higher extent because you haven't had that background in using them. The idea that you can just learn to write kanji and then retain it without ever using it is, in the case of most people, simply a myth. So I would ask myself, if I were seriously interested in learning kanji, when am I going to use them? Am I going to use them enough to retain them? And if it's really important to you to do that, then you should not simply learn them and practice them, but also find ways to use them in reality. Keep a diary in writing. Find a Japanese pen pal who will write to you by hand. Such people do exist. Take Japanese calligraphy classes, perhaps. But you're not going to actually acquire the skill and retain the skill of writing kanji unless you actually write kanji. Besides which, from my point of view, practicing writing kanji just so that you can be good at practicing writing kanji is a little bit like making a sign saying, do not throw stones at this sign. But even if that's what you want to do, bear in mind that retention is something that doesn't happen without regular use. So this is a somewhat complex issue. There are various things to bear in mind. But the important thing to realize is that you can learn Japanese, you can read it, you can write it, you can hear it, you can understand it, you can speak it, all without learning how to write kanji. So whether you want to write it or not is a decision you can make without any kind of pressure that you have to write kanji. You don't have to. If you have any questions or comments, please put them in the comments below and I will answer as usual. I'd like to thank my Gold Kokeshi patrons, my producer Angels who make these videos possible, and all my patrons and supporters on Patreon and everywhere. And I'd like to thank you for attending this lesson. これからもよろしくお願いします。Class dismissed.